Hello, this is Dr. Herndon, and in this video, I'll be continuing my discussion on pharmacokinetics and factors that affect drug absorption, as well as talking about drug distribution, metabolism, and excretion. You've already seen how drugs may be absorbed across the cell membranes and how the solubility of the drug, its ionization status, and the pH of the solution can change drug absorption. There are other factors that can affect drug absorption, including the quality of the absorptive surface area, how well the blood supply is to that area, what the dosage form of the drug is, the status of the GI tract, if it happens to be an oral drug we're talking about, and interaction with other drugs. Let's look at oral drug absorption first. Remember, an oral drug must be lipophilic in order to be absorbed across the GI tract mucosa or cell membranes, unless the drug is meant to stay there. Why do you think a drug might be meant to stay in the gastrointestinal tract instead of being absorbed into the bloodstream? So remember, a lipophilic drug has no charge. Another factor affecting absorption of an oral drug is the speed at which the drug passes through the GI tract. Any changes in gastric or intestinal motility, such as that would occur with certain diseases, is either going to speed up or slow down absorption. Remember that most drugs are absorbed in the small intestinal tract. Some drugs are absorbed in the stomach, but most drugs are absorbed in the small intestine, so that anything that speeds up stomach motility is going to increase the rate at which it goes into the small intestine and increase the rate of absorption in the small intestine. Anything that slows down gastric motility is going to delay absorption of that drug through the small intestine. Now, if we look at intestinal motility, some diseases might speed up motility, such as diarrhea or something like that. So anything that speeds up intestinal motility is going to decrease absorption of a drug because it's going to move through quicker and it's going to have less time to be absorbed by the intestinal wall. Conversely, anything that decreases intestinal motility, such as some sort of ileus where the intestine is paralyzed, is going to allow that drug to stay in the intestine longer and actually increase the amount of absorption that occurs. Now let's look at another factor that affects absorption of orally administered drugs. This is called the first pass effect. This refers to the fact that all substances that are absorbed through the intestinal wall eventually reach the hepatic portal vein and get carried back into the liver through the hepatic portal circulation before ever going into the systemic circulation. This means that the liver, whose job it is to detoxify various different substances, may end up breaking down or extensively removing certain drugs before they ever reach the circulation. This is called the first pass effect. What do you think would happen if the liver was diseased? Do you think that the drugs would be present in higher concentrations in the blood or lower concentrations in the blood? We will talk about that in class. Another factor that will affect how well an oral drug is absorbed is the actual functional absorptive surface area of the gastrointestinal tract. Let's look at a photo of a bovine small intestine that has some areas of healthy villi and some necrotic areas due to the viral disease, bovine viral diarrhea, or BVD. You can see in this case how there is some areas where the villi or the intestinal surface looks somewhat normal, but then there are areas that are ulcerated. So that particular area right there is not going to have any absorptive capacity at all. Now maybe this is not such a big deal with a few little areas here and there. However, in an intestinal tract that has very large areas of damage, such as this equine large colon, which has been actually damaged by drugs themselves, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, you can see how there's very little absorptive surface area left. Now let's look at another factor that can affect absorption of an oral drug. These are drug interactions or food interactions. Certain oral drugs, when combined with either other drugs or foods, will have decreased absorption due to either binding of a drug with something or a change in the chemical nature of a drug. The best example is the group of antibiotics called the tetracyclines, which includes doxycycline and oxytetracycline. When taken with milk or antacids or any other products that contain aluminum, calcium, iron, magnesium, zinc, or bismuth, the tetracycline becomes chelated with the cations, which will reduce its absorption. It's recommended that all oral tetracycline antibiotics be given at least 1 to 2 hours either before one of these products are given or 1 to 2 hours afterwards. Now let's look at factors affecting absorption of parenteral drug. A parenteral drug is one that's injected into the body. First off, the drug must be hydrophilic or water-soluble in order to be carried throughout the extracellular fluid and the bloodstream. Secondly, changes in tissue perfusion or blood supply to an area and also changes in temperature or body temperature to the area where the drug is injected will affect the absorption. A drug in a well-perfused site, such as muscle, which has lots of capillaries, will be more quickly absorbed than a drug in a poorly perfused site, such as the subcutaneous tissue. Poor perfusion, which is seen with conditions like shock or heart failure, is going to reduce the absorption of a drug. The fight or flight response may actually speed up the absorption of a drug by speeding up the heart rate. The temperature at the site of injection will also affect the absorption of a drug. A cold body is going to experience vasoconstriction of the muscles, which will decrease blood perfusion to an area and thus decrease drug absorption. The application of heat or massage to a cold muscle on the body may actually speed up the rate of drug absorption of an IM drug. Now let's look at the pharmacokinetic process called drug distribution. This is a process by which a drug is carried from the site of absorption to the site of action in a target cell. In order for this to happen, the drug has to travel through the extracellular fluid, into the capillaries via the plasma, then out of the capillaries, into the interstitial fluid, and then into the target cells. Eventually, an equilibrium is reached between the cells and the interstitial fluids and the plasma. Once a drug reaches the capillary beds, the drug does not have to be lipophilic in order to cross the endothelial wall to get into the tissues. It can simply pass through small gaps between cells in order to travel into the tissues. Larger molecules, such as proteins, however, are not able to pass through these gaps. One exception to this is in the brain. The brain has what's called the blood-brain barrier. In this case, the endothelial cells of the capillaries that surround the brain have what's called tight junctions. Their job is to keep out most foreign substances, such as drugs. Only lipophilic molecules can pass through these capillaries into the brain. It's the same in the placenta as well. It's the body's job to protect these sensitive sites from toxins and drugs and other things. Drug distribution depends on the perfusion of the tissues as well. Similar to drug absorption, drugs will be distributed most rapidly and in the highest concentrations to well-perfused tissues, such as well-exercised skeletal muscles, the liver, the kidney, and the brain. Conditions such as shock and heart failure decrease tissue perfusion to these different organs and will therefore decrease drug distribution to the tissues as well. Some drugs rely on large plasma proteins in order to be distributed throughout the blood and stay in the circulation. Albumin is an example of one of these proteins. Only the free or unbound drug can leave the circulation and travel to tissues. The protein-bound drug will stay in the circulation. So the equilibrium between free or unbound drug and protein-bound drug will shift as more drug leaves the blood and goes into the capillaries and then into the tissues. And any changes or decreases in the plasma protein levels will increase the amount of drug that can travel to the tissues, which can potentially cause adverse reactions. Now let's look at the process of drug metabolism, otherwise known as biotransformation. This is the process by which a drug is changed from the form it enters the body into the form that can be eliminated out of the body. The liver in this picture is the primary organ conducting the enzymatic metabolic reactions that break down drugs, but there is also some biotransformation that occurs in the lungs, the skin, and the GI tract. Some very lipid-soluble drugs will get incorporated into bile to be excreted through the GI tract and into the feces. The term metabolite refers to a biotransformed drug. It's usually inactive, but some metabolites have drug activity. The liver may perform chemical reactions such as oxidation, reduction, hydrolysis, or conjugation on a drug in the process of metabolism. Conjugation with glucuronic acid will make a drug more soluble and more likely to be eliminated by the kidney. The biotransformation of drugs varies from species to species. One notable example is in cats. Cats cannot easily synthesize glucuronic acid, so certain drugs that typically get conjugated and excreted are metabolized much more slowly and much more poorly. An example are the salicylate compounds such as aspirin. With these drugs, we have to regulate dosing rates so that we spread it out, so we give the liver time to metabolize this drug. Also, very young animals, such as this kitten, don't have fully functional livers for days to weeks after birth. Also, they have a more permeable blood-brain barrier and lower blood albumin levels. They also have less body fat and a higher percentage of body water. All of these facts cause neonates to be much more susceptible to adverse effects of drugs, and doses must be lowered accordingly in young animals. The fourth process of pharmacokinetics is drug elimination. The kidneys are the most common organ that eliminates drugs once metabolized, though some drugs are eliminated through the kidney virtually unmetabolized. As I mentioned, the liver can eliminate some drugs through the bile and into the feces. For the most part, drugs must be in their water-soluble form to be eliminated through the kidneys. Other routes of elimination include through the milk and the mammary glands, out through the lungs, other glands, and through the skin. Because it takes a while for a drug to be absorbed and metabolized and distributed and eventually eliminated through the body, we know that the drug is going to be in muscle tissues and milk in the eggs of certain food-producing animals that have been given medications. Food animal drugs must have drug withdrawal time stated on the label. A withdrawal time is the period of time after drug treatment during which eggs or milk must be discarded from an animal, or during which time an animal cannot be used for meat. Examples of drugs requiring adherence to specific withdrawal times include antibiotics and non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. You can look up drug withdrawal times either on the drug label, or you can also look it up on the website called the Food Animal Residue Avoidance Data Bank. This lists all the different drugs used in food animals and what the withdrawal times are.